Okay, excellent. Fantastico. All right, problem solved. So anyway, so Fran, I guess we were thinking about coming this from a couple of different perspectives. One is talking to us about some of the most important considerations when we think about designing a room for critical listening. And I think that, you know, while there's a wide latitude of from an aesthetic point of view about whether you like a little bit more of this or a little bit less of that in terms of an aesthetic, there probably are some very basic kind of principles that are important to consider when making a room where we can make good decisions in creating recordings, mixing recordings, mastering recordings, and even maybe, well, I guess if you're designing an environment for somebody to just listen to music, then maybe all bets are off and they can listen to whatever they want to listen to as a consumer. I don't know how much of that work you do or how much of a call there is, but just sort of leaving that aside for a moment. So anyway, so there's the room design, and then there's the world that many people who are involved in music production live in, which is I walk into a space that already exists. How do I make it better? Is it possible to make it better? What kinds of things does it make sense to think about trying to improve, and what kinds of problems does it not? So I'd like to sort of hand this off to you and maybe have you talk to us, maybe starting with the perspective of what do you think about when you think about making a good listening environment? What are the essential important ingredients?
Well, that is a pretty broad question and certainly opens us up for a broad discussion. I think that finding a good space to start with is so key. So many people come to me and they've already committed to a certain room or maybe they've rented a space that, you know, that they see in the floor plan. Here's a control room, here's an ISO booth. Maybe they already have a vision in their head about how to best utilize a space. You have to have an open mind. You have to keep your options open. One of the reasons you're hiring a designer or a consultant is to give you advice. So you want to listen to the advice. You want to choose whether you should take the advice, obviously, but you certainly want to listen. Finding a good basic room to start with is really important. And if we start on the kind of the low end of this, where you've got an existing room and you're going to decide how much improvements you can afford to make or how many improvements it makes sense to make, one of the key things to look at is the room a quiet room, right? Am I going to have an acceptable noise floor in this room? Don't pick the room next to the mechanical closet. Can't tell you how many studios or would-be studios I've walked into where they have decided the control room should go right next to the mechanical closet. I guess it was a wise choice over putting the vocal booth next to the mechanical closet, but right. only in a small amount. Yeah. So finding a quiet space, finding a space that's going to be conducive to you being creative. So if that means you like to work in a black box and you don't like to see the outside world and you like to get very zoomed in on your creativity, don't put it in the front office. Save that for somebody who really wants windows and wants sunlight. But these days, most of the rooms we do are incorporating as much natural light as possible, whenever possible. Of course, Jonathan, you're sitting in a group of rooms that are in the middle of the building and thus far are precluded from having any natural sunlight, but it's not far away. You know, it's a door or two away from you being able to look outside and see whether it's raining or, you know.
I do get natural light from time to time, yes.
Yeah, exactly. I can tell you've got a nice tan going, but I think the next thing after, you know, finding a space that it makes sense to put a studio in as far as a noise floor and a space that makes sense as far as your creative needs, which are very individual. It's one of those things we try to interview somebody about when we're first starting a job. What do you want with your studio? Because it's your studio, it's not my studio. Probably the next biggest thing is finding a room that's acoustically friendly for a listening environment. What does that mean? biggest factor is room dimensions, room proportions. There are a ton of resources out there now. You guys can do a lot of what we do on the first part of the drawing board, if you will, which is a study of room dimensions and modal analysis based on raw room dimensions. So a lot of people go into DIY studios and they say, well, the first thing I have to do is put up some unparalleled walls and make sure that I don't have anything that's, you know, 90 degrees and you know, get all these odd angles going. And they build a bunch of asymmetrical, very strange rooms. And sometimes they're really lucky and they sound great, and sometimes not so much. FM design, as a rule, we're big believers in rectangular rooms as starting points. You're sitting in a couple right now. Most of the mastering rooms, most of, not all of them, but most of the ones that I've designed are based on rectangular shells, rectangular boxes. I know at least one or two guys who are on the chat right now who are sitting in rooms that are based on rectangular boxes that I may or may not have had something to do with. So there's nothing wrong with a rectangle, I guess, is the moral of that story. There can be something really wrong if the dimensions are 15 by 15 by 15. It could be equally just as bad if it's 10 by 20 by 10.
Yeah.
So I think most of the guys who are on here have some understanding that there's a modal characteristic to a room that's influenced by the room dimensions. A really quick internet search, guys, and you'll find Excel sheets or Java plugins. You'll find any number of tools that are available to help you analyze the dimensions of your room. If you hire me, it's one of the first things I'm going to do when I come in, is do an analysis of the dimensions of your room. So finding a good spot, finding a quiet spot, finding a creatively conducive spot, and then starts the technology. Okay, yep. Do these dimensions work? If they don't, guess what, guys? You can make the room smaller pretty easily. You can put up a false wall or an additional partition. You can tweak it. Am I going to put ceilings in the room? If I am, then that factors into the dimensions of the room. So a little bit of homework, and you can start off with a good rectangle, and then move on to placement and treatments of the rectangle. Do you want me to go on about this a little bit more? Because if you were to come like one notch up for this, and you're starting to shop for like commercial space to build a studio in, that opens up another laundry list of things that you need to look at that make it a good space. But I don't want to get too sidetracked if you want to go in another direction.
Well, it's interesting. Why don't you rattle off a few of them? It's interesting, and I think it helps to sort of sketch out. You know, one of the questions that comes to my mind is, are there some basic starting points, numbers, parameters that that kind of set the bar above which you need to go in order to think about investing in building a space? So maybe if you mention some of what these are, it'll help to inform that question.
Well, if you come back to some of the points we just made, a quiet space. What's quiet enough?
Yeah, what is quiet enough?
Quiet enough is that when you go in the room and sit down and be quiet, is there noise there that's going to bother you listening to moderately loud music, not loud music? Getting back to everything Brian was talking about, your goal shouldn't be to overpower the noise of your room. Your goal should be to be able to listen softly, and then for brief periods of time, loud, and a lot of time, somewhere in the middle. You know, 78, that number he mentioned as a magic number, one of the questions on the board that I was watching go by was, is this A, is this C? You know, most of the time when they spout single numbers, guys, it's typically A, but he's an audiologist. I'm hoping they're talking C, because A is so hard to rationalize when it comes to music. So much low frequency is rolled off in a dBA measurement that it's hard to, you know, you don't think of 78 SPL. It's probably, you know, 78 A is more, you know, could be more like 85, 86, what you're used to listening to. So if it was A, that gives you guys a little bit more leeway. If it was C, it's much closer to unweighted SPL, which might be what you're measuring with your SPL meter. If you guys have SPL meters, you've done this, you've flicked the filters in and out, you know what I'm talking about. What's quiet enough? I mean, look, you know, we're always shooting for NC20 in these rooms or better. I'm not one of these guys who's designing a lot of science experiments trying to get NC10. There are applications for super quiet rooms, mostly, in my experience, recording voice. One of the most demanding things that we do is voice recording, where the voice is going to be exposed, aka audiobooks, extremely demanding, because they're going to edit in the noise floor all the time. And if the noise floor moves around, those edits are going to get telegraphed like nobody's business. So when you're editing an audiobook, you better have a rock steady, very low noise floor.
That's so interesting. You know, it's funny. It strikes me that for folks who aren't doing that, that would not occur to them.
No, of course it wouldn't. It didn't occur to me until I talked to the guy who I designed the first, you know, studio like that for. I've since designed 3 studios for him and numerous others. And, you know, when you're doing VO for post or something like that, much more forgiving, because it's always voice over. It's over something.
Yes.
It's over, you know, tonight on NBC, or it's over a track. It's over something. Much less critical. Like, you know, my network clients are much less critical of noise floor. You know, NC20, NC25, yeah, whatever. It's great. Because those noise floors come at quite the cost, guys. You know, when you start getting below NC30, things start getting expensive in a hurry. And most of you will find that when you turn on your gear in your drop-dead quiet room, it bumps up to NC25, NC30 in a hurry. So, you know, even just some electronic noise, not even getting into noisy fans, is enough to raise the noise floor a little bit. But, you know, you're mostly dealing with air conditioning when it comes to, you know, comes to noise, assuming you're not parked next to the mechanical room and you don't have, you know, a manufacturing plant upstairs and a disco downstairs, then most of your internal noise issues are air conditioning related.
Yeah.
Other than the parked next to the machines, you've got the noise that travels down the ductwork, and you've got the noise that's induced by the ductwork, the air noise itself. So that's something that you can do that can really make, in my opinion, can make your studio a little bit of a notch above some of the other, you know, low to mid-level studios, is concentrate on doing some really quiet AC. And, you know, as long as it works, it's one of those things that people don't notice until they notice it.
Oh yeah.
It's really hard when you're selling your studio and you spent lots of money building the studio, because if you did everything right, nobody notices that you did everything right. They only notice all the things you didn't do right. They notice that, you know, that the stuff hums when I plug it into one outlet, it doesn't hum in the other one. They notice that, you know, I'm getting noise over here from the air conditioning and not over here. They notice that it sounds good where you're sitting, but where I'm sitting, it sounds like, you know, poop. No. So it's all the things that didn't quite go right that people notice. But as a studio owner, I guess your job is to make your place the place that nobody notices anything in other than your great work, you know.
Right.
You know, noise floor, it's an expensive thing, getting that low noise floor. So I don't think people should go crazy about trying to achieve this NC20 unless you're doing work that demands it.
I will say, I mean, in my experience, just if I may, that in an absolute sense, being able to differentiate between what's coming from the speakers and what's not, you know, is just critical. And whether it's a matter of taking your focus away or judging reverb tails or making EQ decisions, because, you know, in a very noisy environment, it changes your impression of timbre. And, you know, I've made the mistake of trying to work in some noisy environments and coming away and saying, wow, you know, I think I was fighting with the environment.
I'm starting a project right now, and the room that the client wants to turn into a control room has a stairway in it that leads downstairs to a basement. And, you know, all my little red flags and alarms are going off as he's describing this to me, and he sends me some pictures, and I'm like, you know, we have to close this off in one way or another. And I said, there's a plethora of acoustic problems I can think of. You know, one of which that comes to mind is the reverb chamber that you've got a hole into down in the basement here, that, you know, don't think you're not going to hear some return from this, you know, box down there, whatever it may be. And don't think that that's not going to color your work. But you touched on something that made me think of something that I think is a very elegant way of describing what we do and what the listeners should be trying to achieve with their studios. We're in the business of production, right? But a control room, the business of a control room is reproduction. Control rooms should only contribute to production when you turn a knob. The control room should be a very transparent tool. The listening system, the amplifiers, the speakers, the room, should be a pure reproductive system that does not add anything to the production. Now, there are some contemporary schools of thought that have the room being a very active part of this. I don't subscribe to them. I think that the room, you know, the classic live and dead end room with a reflection-free zone and a void of early reflections, it works for a reason, because you're able to pick up all those early cues in the production that allow you to identify how far was something from the mic and how far was something from another mic, and that's what gives it space. Very similar to what Brian was talking about with how your two ears work. And if some of the younger or less experienced listeners don't know about this, read about how stereo works, because stereo is an amazingly complex thing, and it's really beautifully simple when you do it right. But your room should be color-free. I know that sounds obvious, it sounds simple, but so many people don't, you know, oh, yeah, I hear that reverb coming from back there, that doesn't bother me. Oh, that should bother you. You know, you shouldn't be hearing something coming from the back of your control room when you're trying to mix something, because now that's part of the production, not part of the reproduction. Your production should all be in front of you, on the screen or on the knobs. The reproduction's all around you, and it should be crystal clear, and there shouldn't be any coloration going on. So I always say that I'm in the reproduction business. You guys are in the production business.
You bring a couple of things to mind when you talk about the sound should be in front of you, and you're kind of referring to reflected sound as well. And so, well, I want to say two things. First of all, it used to be that gear was noisier. It used to be that there was more of it in the room. It seems like there's an opportunity now for you to design a room and for people to design the inside of it in such a way that whatever's in the room doesn't get in the way of the room. I mean, is that observation hold true for you? Are you finding that people are being smarter because there's a smaller footprint, there's less stuff, large format?
Look, we all know that the predominance of large format consoles is a thing of the past. Most of the rooms we do not have large format consoles in them. Some still do, but most do not. Yeah. So yes, you have an opportunity here to lighten the amount of acoustic footprint that your equipment has if you do it smartly. So a very cleverly designed work surface where you play your angles right and you set your monitors, your display monitors up correctly so that they interfere as minimally as possible with your audio monitors. You know that I noticed I didn't say that they don't interfere, because that's kind of impossible. Everything that falls between you and the playback speakers is in play. So unless you can work on a VR headset, which I'm hoping is just around the corner, where you really can control everything like this, and, you know, then the room becomes a real tool and the gear is out of the way. I'll tell you that empirically, we've had the opportunity on a few larger projects to install the main monitors and measure the room before any of the equipment was installed. And, you know, set everything, do a quick setup and get everything roughly tuned. And then in comes this large console and in comes these racks of gears. And the whole thing just goes right down the toilet. It's gone in a hurry. And all that equipment, you know, not only does it introduce some early reflections, but it also causes low frequency diffraction. You know, below a certain point, sound starts to wrap around things like large consoles, and you get holes in the response that you're never going to fix them. You know, you could try EQing it, but I wouldn't recommend it. So, yes, Jonathan, you're 100% right. Given today's relatively small equipment footprint, this problem should be getting smaller and smaller. Sometimes it is, in my experience, sometimes it's not. People are just putting up more and more video monitors, more and more. It's interesting.
Yeah. So, well, and actually somebody, I happen to notice a question here, which plays into that. So
how do we place our display monitors?
Yeah. I mean, you know, we've all got them. We've got the consoles out of the way, but we still got these screens.
Yeah.
And we also have work surfaces in front of us. And this is, you know, what I teach an online mastering course, and one of the things we do in the first week is we have the students describe their setups, and they send pictures. And invariably, they have, you know, a set of monitors sitting on flat on a desktop, and with no angle or whatever. And it's actually some pretty low hanging fruit to talk to them about.
Yeah. Okay. So to address the couple of questions which are interrelated about how do we place our display monitors and how to best minimize early reflections from the computer desk. Those are kind of the same question in different clothing. How to best place my display monitors. If I'm working in stereo, let's start with stereo, because as soon as we get into surround, it gets 10 times more complicated. But if I have to have a clear path to two loudspeakers, start with that being your primary focus. That when I sit at my mix position, I want a clear path to these two speakers. I don't want to be looking around stuff. I don't want to be looking over something. And there's a really simple old school approach that everybody can take. Get yourself a small mirror and start putting it on things. And if you're sitting in the mix position and you put that mirror right here where I have my mouse and I can see a reflection of the speaker, guess what? You're hearing a reflection of the speaker. If you place your video monitors in the middle in front of you, and your video monitor is a thin flat screen style monitor, you're going to get very minimal interaction with the edge of the monitor. I often cannot measure that. And we have, you know, we use a TEF that specifically measures reflections. And if I can't measure that reflection off the edge of the monitor, it's insignificant. Trust me. The much, you know, as long as those monitors are not sitting in front of the speakers, and as long as they're not in a position where if you put a mirror on them, you're going to see a reflection of the speaker, flat screens can be introduced into this work area without destroying things. The desk surface is much more difficult to get rid of. We have found ourselves fashioning triangular pieces of absorptive material that get placed at the reflection point on the desk. And, you know, yeah, you can still put a stapler there. You can put a pen holder there. You could even probably put a phone there. It's just that stark flat surface that really, causes the early reflection. And often in small rooms, we'll measure the left and we'll measure the right. And the side that's got the phone on it, I got no problems. The side that doesn't have something on it, I've got this very evident stark reflection that's causing a very evident comb filter in the mid-range and high frequency response. And that's what it does, guys. It causes this comb filtering that you'll see in the frequency response. And as you move your head around, that comb filter will shift because you're changing the time relationship. Get rid of the desk, somebody says. Yeah, get rid of the desk. But, you know, most people want to put their stuff on something. If you get a small enough cart and you're comfortable doing this where you can put your KVM setup and you can see all the way from floor, you know, all the way up to the top of your monitors and nothing's in the way, you've pretty much solved the problem. You know, for the most part, you've solved the problem. There may be something in that rig that's causing the first reflection, but if you can get that clear path, then you've pretty much solved the problem. Most people can't. I'll tell you right now, most can't, because most people have a big enough desk that there's going to be a reflection point somewhere off of that.
Yeah. For years, I've been dying for the perfectly silent projector. So get rid of a screen, have some acoustically transparent projection, you know, fabric.
Mm-hmm.
But the projectors just aren't there. So
there, I don't know if it's silent.
I don't have to pay for them. You know, so. Great. So back to the room design. Is there anything that's sort of, I don't know, maybe this is a dumb question, but that's in vogue or that's changed from the standpoint of a monitoring aesthetic over the last several years? And does the aesthetic change in response to musical genre or style?
I don't know if I have a good answer. Is there anything that's in vogue? I'm so far out of being in vogue. I do make a point to know the music of everybody who I work with, but I may not know it before I work with you. And I'm a very, got very eclectic musical taste because of that factor, because I work with a very varied client base, you know, from adult contemporary to the hardcore hip hop to everything in between.
Yeah.
So I do listen to a lot of different music. What's in,
you don't have to go. This just sort of occurred to me. So,
well, we all know that you know, large Augsburger monitors are and will remain the choice for urban music production, mostly because, very logically, because they mimic the environments that the music will be played in. They're high distortion, you know, high output, two-way sound systems like you're going to find in a club these days, and you know, they sound like a Jeep on overdrive, and they sound like a club when you go there. They are not reference monitors, and they're not accurate. They're not meant to be. We have a lot of fun trying to tune those systems because you have to pick a volume. You know, you have to kind of pick the, somebody show me what volume you want to listen to, and then we'll tune it for that volume because it changes wildly over volume, you know. But I shouldn't be getting into talking about stuff like that.
Yeah, but you raise an interesting question for me, which, and I talked to students about this, and maybe I can learn something by your comments. So, you know, I'm often asked, well, shouldn't I be trying to create a monitoring system that sounds like the reproduction system? The problem that I, or the question that I have with that construct is there really such a thing? I mean, there are characteristics like a two-way system and subs and so on and so forth, but is there really such a thing as a single sonic signature of a sound system like that?
No.
And so if you try to create an anomaly in your space and work to that anomaly, you're relying on that same anomaly showing up everywhere else.
Look, this gets right back to the very in vogue practice in the 80s and 90s of mixing on horrible sounding near field monitors, because if I make it sound good on these, it sounds good everywhere. Look, guys, speakers are just tools. Can I build a really nice boat with a crappy hammer and a crappy saw? If I spend enough time and I really practice at it, yes, I can. It would be way more efficient to build it with a very nice, you know, set of tools. So your speakers are just tools, just like your room is. You can learn to use a rusty, falling apart set of tools to do a good job. I personally have made records in a closet at a nightclub that came out pretty darn good. So it can be done on headphones, you know, with a bunch of gear that I borrowed from everybody I knew. So my belief about monitor systems in general has become that there's no such thing as too accurate a monitor system. And this doesn't just apply to your world, Jonathan. This applies to the recording world as well. Monitors give you information. So if they give you extended high frequency bandwidth and they give you extended low frequency bandwidth, that's just information, guys. The monitors can't sound too good. They can sound inaccurately good if they make something that doesn't sound good because they are hyped in some way, then that isn't good. But an accurate monitor system that's tuned to, now, there is some latitude in the tuning here, you know, tuned to your style of listening, can't be too accurate, in my opinion. So there's no such thing as these monitors sound too good. I do not buy that. I'm not one who believes that. You may know, I know you know, the other participants may know that we sell monitors as well. And a lot of people who I've put monitors in their rooms have come back and said, man, I can't tell you how amazing it is to actually hear stuff that I've never heard before. And the fact that I can listen very soft medium or very loud on the same set of speakers and get all the information I need out of them, and that it took them no time to learn how to use their room monitor system when it was a good room and a good monitor system. That's the best testament I can get from anybody about our work, is that, hey, we moved right in and we started doing great work, you know? And so I believe what's happened in the past decade or so is that monitor systems have gotten much better. From the least expensive to the most expensive, as a rule, they've gotten much better. Technology's improved, driver technology's improved, the manufacturing process has improved, and manufacturers as a whole have become more technical and more educated about really what they're doing. There's a lot of companies building speakers that weren't JBL and didn't really know what they were doing. You know, JBL's always kind of knew what they were doing because they invented most of the technology. But there's a lot of good monitors out there. So, you know, it does become a choice of, you know, at some point between, you know, yellow, orange, or green, which do I like? But accurate, good sounding monitors are what I think are in vogue and what should be in vogue. So I don't know if you got to that.
When I started working as a audio engineer proper, which was 1982 or so, the expectation was that a studio monitor speaker would have to sound bad to do a good job. And I'm so grateful for the fact that that expectation has gone away, that we actually have monitor speakers that where you can enjoy your work.
Me too. I didn't like that part of the business.
Oh my gosh. So can I ask you about headphones?
Okay.
It makes no sense to talk with a studio designer about
headphones. Bad.
Yeah. Well, so, okay, good. So tell us why they're bad.
No, headphones are just a tool. I know lots of guys who work in really good rooms who still whip out a good set of headphones and put them on. Yep. You know, there's some things you can judge in a, it's kind of like taking everything else out of the equation, right? Now it's this. Yep. And if I know this really well, why wouldn't I want to reference it at some point? Obviously, stereo is a very different experience. It's a binaural experience in headphones. It's not a stereo experience. So don't judge, you know, those kind of things on headphones is my advice. Judge those on a full range, accurate monitor.
Panning, depth of field.
Yes. Yes. Depth of field, 3D positioning, panning, relative levels of reverb and, you know, and effects like that, because that's all going to change when you go into a binaural scenario. I'm not a headphone aficionado. So if my partner was here, he knows so much more about headphones, but, there probably are headphones now that, because of all the technology, that probably will reproduce a stereo field in a binaural set of speakers. Yeah. But I don't know about that. So
I have a Grace DDA at home that has a crossfeed parameter to send some of that crosstalk that happens naturally. It's not the same, but it's an interesting phenomenon.
I don't have a problem with headphones. I think that it's just another tool. And if you have a pair of headphones that you're partial to, you know, I mean, look, why in the 80s and 90s, why did everybody have to run out to the car to listen to the mix? Because the speakers in the studio suck. You know? So we had to go listen in the lounge on a boombox in the car because we weren't really sure what was going on. You know, I mean, it was the truth. Now, hopefully, we can design studios and we can design listening environment, listening systems, acoustic stethoscope.
So, if I may, you know, I think we should continue for maybe another few minutes, and then I think we should go to some of the other questions.
Absolutely. The questions have been fantastic. I'm like scanning them as they come by here.
Yeah, I can tell, and you're awesome at that. One of the things you mentioned is that you do have a Shopping for a Space 101 document.
Yes.
That's available on your website, is that correct?
No, you have to pay me to get it, but I'm going to tell everybody about it for free tonight. It's we don't have that kind of website. We have a very
potential. I see. I'm sorry, I misspoke. Yes, but anyway, that's there's some basic guidelines and guidance.
Yeah, let's talk about that. This set of guidelines that I kind of have committed to memory relates to renting a space. You know, it's a lot of it is about that process of renting a space and finding a good place to be home to your studio. So some of the obvious things that we've kind of touched on before is, you know, you don't want to be directly over the subway. You don't want to be on the 2 mile final approach to the airport. You don't want to be within a couple of hundred meters of a train station or a train track. You know, these may seem so obvious, but boy, I can't tell you how many times I have been to that place, literally where there's a train track just outside the studio. And they're like, we can stop that noise, right?
That's probably no coincidence that probably those are where the rents are cheap.
Maybe.
Because they're next to this, you know, airport.
Maybe. And then it comes down to kind of touching back on the first point. Get a space that's going to work for what you want to do. If you're going to build a moderate to big size control room, you need to have at least, you know, 20 feet clear in one direction between structural encumbrances, such as columns and outside walls. So, you know, look at that. If you're looking at a space that's got a column every 12 feet, you're probably not going to be able to build a good size control room in there without capturing multiple columns, which is really a pain in the neck and makes isolation, you know, very, very difficult. Ceiling heights, no such thing as too much. Everybody wants to know how much height do I need. Well, once again, getting back to some of the first things we talked about, it has a lot to do with how big the other dimensions are going to be. But rule of thumb, if you want to, you know, end up with somewhere around 10 feet and you're going to float your rooms, build up floors and a ceiling that's decoupled, you're going to need at least another 18 inches. And this is below whatever the lowest structural encumbrance is. So if that's a beam or a large sprinkler pipe. So real estate agents are great at telling you, this place has 14-foot ceilings. You're going to love it. It's 14 foot from slab to slab, and then it's got, you know, 18-inch beams and a sprinkler pipe a foot below that and electrical conduits running here. And, you know, if you measure it to the lowest encumbrance, it's only 10 and a half feet. Now I can't get you a 10-foot floating room in there. So, you know, a little common sense about that stuff. Most of this is common sense, but I think a lot of people are shopping for studio space are in denial. That's what I think. So they want to rationalize the space that they find because they've looked so hard and they want to say, I've found it. This is the space. This is my space. And then you give them a checklist and they realize that like four or five of the big questions they can't answer or they fail. A really big one, guys, is don't waste your time looking at buildings that are union only. It will drive the cost of your project astronomically through the roof. Most of us can't afford it, including most of my, you know, multi-mega zillion-dollar customers. They don't even want to do projects in union-only buildings. So forget those buildings. Check with the landlord right away and say, are we going to be able to bring in our contractor? What are your rules about bringing in outside contractors? Yes, we understand he needs to be licensed. Yes, we understand he needs to be insured. But, you know, will we be able to bring in our contractors? Will you be able to load materials into your space? So if your space is on the sixth floor, is there an elevator? That's a good start. Is there an elevator that's big enough to put a 4x8 sheet of material in? That's a better place. Is there an elevator that's big enough to put 10 or 12 foot long studs in? So these are all, you know, kind of common sense things. And, you know, great spaces have freight elevators, you know, and you can put big stuff in them, but a lot of buildings don't. So you got to think about the ergonomics of actually building something there. Let me see, what am I not bringing up that are big points on the list here? Neighbors, who are my neighbors in the building? What kind of building is this? Is it a professional building? Are there doctors and lawyers in the building? A red flag, doctors hate pneumonias, and lawyers will sue you. So, you know, you want a professional building where there's going to be the types of customers who aren't going to make a lot of noise, you know, no manufacturing, and they're not going to be bothered if a little bit of noise gets out of your place.
Yeah.
Residential buildings, I have major agita whenever anybody wants to do this in a residential setting. Even mixed use buildings make me very nervous. Yes, it can be done. Yeah, we do it fairly regularly, but it's expensive.
Yeah.
So just be prepared. If you're going to try to do this in a mixed use building where there might be, you know, residential floors, a couple of floors above you, remember that once low frequency sound gets into a building, structure borne sound gets in, it travels very easily. So you can bother people 10 stories away with your bass drum if it's into the structure of the building. So don't take it lightly.
You know, just to give a little perspective on this, somebody had just written in something about, well, you know, my space, it looks like I'll never have Van Halen as a client, you know, because the space is totally untenable. I think it took me, you know, I went through a series of rooms, and as my work got better, as I became more successful, I was able to think about upgrading. So it was an incremental thing. I think there are very few people, and I think this is justifiable, who just, you know, their first room is like the Valhalla, is the most beautiful studio space. So just sort of want to give a little perspective there. But I want to call out something you said to me the other day, and we were having a conversation about control room size. We were talking about, you know, after you've made a good sounding room, and the next thing is to put your stuff and yourself in the room in a place. And there's some iterative, you know, process about where the speaker is going to sound best. You've got a room that's going to perform well on paper, and generally it will, but there's still some work to be done.
Yep.
If you don't have enough real estate, and this was the point that you made to me, which I'd never really heard sort of, you know, said this eloquently, if you don't have enough room, you just can't make all the adjustments you'd want to make. You may not be able to get everything in the spot to optimize.
You can size yourself out of tunability is what it comes down to. So if you're going to put your speakers and your desk and your gear, and you're going to front load the room, which in our world means we're going to kind of put everything in the front portion of the room, not set it up like a hi-fi listening environment where you've got a, you know, speakers at 1/3, listener at 2/3 kind of thing. It's very possible that what's going to happen here is you're going to end up jamming your stuff up so close, and you're not going to leave yourself a lot of room to move the speakers or your listening position around. And 9 times out of 10, guys are going to wire everything up and get everything running before they think, oh man, should we have somebody come over and tune this for us? Yeah. Should we think about tuning it ourselves before we hardwire everything in? Yeah. So let me make it very plain. The single biggest thing anybody can do, including me, to tune your pre-existing control room is move things around. This is the single biggest thing, moving the sound sources and moving the listener. So spend every mastering engineer who's been through this at all will tell you the days they spend moving speakers around, listening, moving speakers around, listening, moving their chair around, listening, moving chair and speaker, listening. This is what we do when we come to tune your room. We do it a little bit more electronically, a little bit more with technology. So I spend a lot of time trying to optimize the bass loading of the speaker in the room, and then we get into the finer points of, you know, matching the two sides perfectly, getting just the right amount of toe in, where's the right overshoot for these speakers in this room. You know, you don't want the speakers to focus at your nose. Most of the time you want the speakers to focus somewhere behind your head. And it gets very, when the speakers focus at your nose, it's very easy to fall out of it, have your stereo image fall apart, and you have this pinpoint hot spot, you know, or sweet spot. When we do big monitors in a room, just as a point of reference, guys, they often shoot 30 inches behind the mix position's head. So that's, you know, those are speakers that are 9-10 feet away, but that's, you know, 30 inches of overshoot. So leave yourself room to move your stuff around, and either do it yourself empirically by listening, or getting clever and combining your iPhone RTA and some noise or some test signals, and trying to optimize low frequency first, because that's the hard one. Try to get the best add of you know, the smoothest low frequency response at the mix position that you can get. And as a rule of thumb, you're going to find as you push your speakers farther, you know, closer to the corner of the room, you're going to get more low end. But, you know, remember, it's not just, you're not just playing with the modal qualities of the room. You're playing with what's called speaker boundary interference, which is the relationship of the woofer to all the boundaries around it. So just like there's smart things to do with the rectangle in the room, there's smart things to do with where you place your woofer. You don't want to be the same distance from the floor and the ceiling. So if your room is 8 foot high and you've got Diapolito speakers, you're screwed because you're going to put your tweeter at 4 feet and the woofers are going to be equidistant from the floor and the ceiling. So looks like that. So we had that situation here. And we ended up having to drop the speakers about 10 inches and use really short chairs to listen.
Yeah. So
the room was 8 feet tall and we were setting up Diapolito style speakers and two woofers with a tweeter in the middle. And there was no way around the fact that we had to change the height of the listening position to fix that. So yeah, that's an important one. Thanks for remembering that, John.
Yeah. Well, and you touched on something. So one of the questions is how far back should I be from my speakers? And he mentions an 8-inch, I think he meant JBL. But, you know, can you just a couple of comments about distance and who's that? That's from Bruce Baker. Distance from speakers and the implications of being closer or further away.
Yeah. You want to be far enough away from your speakers that they become coherent. So there's usually some critical distance where a two-way or even to more extent a three-way monitor becomes coherent. Most people are probably listening on two-way monitors. You know, you want to be able to have a coherent wavefront presented by that loudspeaker system, not two discrete wavefronts coming from two drivers. So most of the small speakers that are designed today can get coherent within a meter, to be honest with you. So it becomes more of an equation of where do these speakers work in relationship to everything else that I've got to get in front of me. You know, some people actually find at home on my little synth rig that I have set up, my speakers are quite close to me and I'm very comfortable with that. I've got two-way Tannoy 6.5 PBMs, old speakers, but you know, 6.5-inch woofer. I have them quite close because I find that I don't have anything in between me and the speakers and I'm very comfortable with that. And all the gear is kind of in between the speakers. It's a very small setup, guys, really, really small. Yeah. There is no magic question for that magic answer for your question. And it is different for every speaker. The more drivers you put into the speaker, as a rule of thumb, the more distance you have to get for that to become coherent. Like the speakers you used to use, Jonathan, you had to be, I think it was 7 or 8 feet away from those before they became coherent.
Guess what, Fran? I'm looking at them.
Oh, they're still there?
They're here.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Those speakers there, you have to be a good 7 or 8 feet away from those to for it to get coherent, no?
No, I think I'm a good 8 feet away from them.
Okay, there you go.
Another question, a couple of people have sort of have asked this. Isolating speakers, decoupling speakers.
Mm-hmm. I saw those going by, yeah.
Sleds, foam, stands.
It's a good thing. Do it. Anything that you can use to decouple your speaker from whatever surface it's sitting on, but very specifically, if it's sitting on your desk or your console, if you have one, it's just going to clean up that low, mid-range, high bass area a lot. And that's the general benefit from it. You know, also, you know, what you don't want is you don't want the speaker to be on something so springy that it moves from its own energy. You know, that sounds pretty obvious, but if your speaker's vibrating around, what are you doing? You're destroying all your high frequency, you know, ultra high frequency information. So yeah, but I'm a big believer in decoupling of speakers. Even when we put them in the wall, we use a thick piece of sorbethene rubber that we cut to size in the four corners based on the weight of the speaker. There is a little bit of science behind here. You can actually download a sorbethane calculator, guys. I think it's the Sorbothane company, Sorbothane, that has this calculator on their website. And if you are trying to isolate larger speakers that actually weigh, you know, 30, 40, 150, 300, 600 pounds, you can calculate how big a piece of sorbethane you need to get efficient isolation at, and you tell it, what frequency do I want to isolate? And a little bit of iterative entering of data, and you can get a good isolation.
Great.
5.5 feet apart, a good distance. How big a room and how big a speaker? In general, sure, it's plenty big enough, unless we're talking about huge four-way monitors, what's next, Jonathan? Which one should we go to next?
Well, I think we have time for one more here. And so Hayden Myhill asked something about diffusion and absorption. Are they more effective as a sail above my mix position?
Okay, that's a good question and a common question.
Yep.
If we're going to treat reflections and early reflections in the room, certainly the ceiling is just as important as the sidewalls. It's probably, in many rooms, closer to me than the sidewalls might be. So I'm a big believer in that area between your mix position and the speakers being very absorptive. That's how we control reflections. So guys, we've been staring at this room that I designed behind Jonathan the whole time, and you see all these reflective and diffuse surfaces, but they're all behind him, and they're all significantly behind him, in placed in such a way that the sound travels past him, bounces around back there for a while, and then comes back to him after some pre-prescribed amount of time. The initial time gap is the technical term for that. And those are no longer early reflections. Now they're mid-room reflections, and they actually enhance imaging, as opposed to these reflections that come to you in that 10, 12, 14 millisecond range, which destroy imaging. So soft over the console is the answer, my answer to the question. In a home theater, kind of like in a hi-fi environment, which you touched on at the very beginning, people use diffusers all over the place, because they're not in the reproduction business. They're getting into the production business. They want to make that movie sound better. They don't want to hear what the guy makes. They want to make it sound better. So home theater people love to put diffusion everywhere where it doesn't make any sense. And I see it all the time. If you've got a big enough room, you can put it everywhere, because now you're far enough away from it. In smaller rooms, like most of us are probably working in, I saw the 350 square foot question from Jesse. That's a great size for a control room. We do a boatload of control rooms in the 300 to 350 square foot range, just for your information. So,
fantastic. All right. So I think, unfortunately, we're probably about 100% over our predicted time. Predicted, and Brian also, we could go on forever.
Yeah, I can
Are you going to be out at AES, by the way, at the Audio Engineering Society conference?
I will be at AES, and I will also be at NAMM this year. So I'm going
to
be.
I also know you've been at the Parsons Audio Expo. So if any of you ever have a chance to go to one of those shows, and you'll have a chance to maybe say hello to Fran and maybe be lucky enough to hear him speak on a panel as well. But I really appreciate your taking the time and giving us some perspective on, you know, what I think is probably the most important tool that we have in our facilities, which is, you know, where we sit and listen.
And I appreciate you including me, because I love talking about this stuff. I really do. I always tell people that a big part of what we do is educating our customers. And I spend a lot of time with people on the phone who I know are never going to be customers, because I want them to go in the right direction. So I hope we were able to do a little bit of that tonight.
Well, thanks so much. I really appreciate it. And I look forward to seeing you soon.
Awesome.
And so thanks, Fran. And so for everybody out there, I think before we sign off, I just want to remind you, we'll have another episode of Headroom next month. Look for some other hands-on and more focused content in October, and then we'll be back to our regular Headroom program in November. There's the new audio podcast with Sean Greenhall. Thanks again to Lars for hanging in there and Melissa, and thank you all for showing up. I appreciate it. Feel free to send in any follow-up questions to headroom@iZotope.com, and have a great evening. I'm going to try to remember to turn off my microphone this time. Take care.